Okay, I'm going to start today with a review. We had just done the difference quotient and learned how to take f of x and g of x, and we already knew how to add, subtract, multiply, and divide a couple functions. But then you just learned how to handle it when they have domain issues. Would you please, to start with, just see if you remember how to get the domain for f, domain of f, and the domain for G. Take a moment and figure out their separate domains first. Then I'm going to ask you to combine them like we did yesterday. So find the domain of f and the domain of G. If I were you, I'd make them number lines because then it's so much easier later to see where they overlap. Okay, I'm hoping by now you're done. Domain of f would be. Honestly, I know you can try to do this in your head, but I would really recommend doing this and then solving it and then putting it on a number line. Here's negative 5, works, and bigger than that. Why is that handy? Because then I can move the number lines over and make them overlap later when we're figuring out the combos. All right, domain of g is. It can't be that. Again, don't try to do it in your head. Say x minus 4 not equal to 0. Add 4, x not equal to 4, and then make a number line for that. Here's 4. Can't be that. Can be everything else. Raise your hand if you had those two domains correct. All right, good. Next, let's see what would happen if we did a simpler one. What's f of x times g of x, which we sometimes write f times g of x. Figure out what is the answer to that and then what is the domain for that. When you're done, you can write your answer for the domain as a number line. Or interval notation. Either one's okay. We'll always follow the directions on the test. If the test says it must be an interval, then s must be an interval. But I'd always start with a number line. You can always make those into interval pretty easy. All right, if you're multiplying these two functions, I hope you just said, well, it's the square root of x plus 5 times 1 over x minus 4. Can you actually put them together? Yes, you can. You can make them into one big fraction if you realize that's got a denominator of 1. And then it's square root of x plus 5 over x minus 4. Now that function has a domain of what? Well, we should go back to how do you do those combo domains? You put this one, oh, that's all stuck together. This one and this one next to each other. I got to make sure I put that negative 5 in the right spot because that wouldn't make sense. That's not where negative 5 is. Negative 5 would be like way over here. And I ask myself, where do these overlap? Well, here's a place that they overlap from 4 to infinity, but that's not the only place they overlap, right? Do you get they also overlap in front of the 4 up until the negative 5? This one, remember, it goes forever on top. Like, forever is forever. I don't want to draw forever, but. Okay, so there's two areas that would work. And this would be from negative 5 to 4. Bracket on the negative 5, but it can't be negative 4. Union with 4 to infinity. There's my answer. If you wanted to write it as a number line, you could. And you would have had to say this. Negative 5 to 4 works here, doesn't work there, and then 4 to infinity works. That number line or this interval is what I was looking for. How many had it right the first time? Sweet. Okay, then, what can make it more complicated? What's the more complicated kind? Yes? Remember? Okay. There was four things you could do: add, subtract, multiply, or divide. What's the complicated kind? Divide. If you divide them, it's more complicated. How? because you have one more number line to try to overlap. There's my two number lines. If I were to do f divided by g of x, no, wait, other way around. I'm going to go g divided by f. And I want you to think that the g's are always on the bottom. G divided by f of x. What's the extra thing that could happen that could crash this function that couldn't have crashed the other functions? It brings in the added possibility of the f function being what? Zero. You can't let f be zero. Look at it. Normally, couldn't this be zero? Yeah, normally it's okay to have it be zero. But when you're dividing, do you get how if the f function is zero, it's going to be a problem? So all you ask yourself for the third number line is, what would make that f function be zero? I draw this number line, and I just, the only thing I care about is the zero thing. So what would make that square root be zero if it was negative 5? So x can't be negative 5. Empty spot. Everything else is okay as far as making this be zero. Nothing else will make it zero, so everything else is okay. This third number line is usually only one thing would make that function be zero. Then I overlap all three of them, and there's only one tiny difference now. What was the difference about? What number? Negative 5 is the only number that'll be different. And it used to work, see? But now, it doesn't. Do you get how negative 5 would kill this divided by this? Because one negative 5 went in here, that'd be a 0. And this divided by 0, it would kill it. So this guy has to make, it's very, very similar, but I have to change it now. Just put an empty spot right there, and that's the correct domain now. And so I just have to change that to a parenthesis. You see why we have to be picky in math? Because that's a whole different domain, just because of one number. Parenthesis versus a bracket's all it takes. But that's true in the real world. Like, there's things that are really picky. You know, if you're the guy designing the iPhone, okay, and you make one little thing wrong in the software, do you get how millions and millions of people are going to be frustrated by your one little tiny thing you did? You got to be careful. What if they make the iPhone have just a little tiny crack, you know, like just a 16th of an inch, even a 32nd of an inch along, like it doesn't quite seal right. Do you get, then it's not waterproof anymore? You can't be even off by a millimeter. Otherwise, it won't be waterproof because the water will get in the crack. Okay, so you know there are times when you gotta be really careful. And pre-calc is one of them. Negatives, parentheses, it's all it takes. Gotta be extra paranoid and careful on your tests. We make the tests not that long, so you can take your time to check them thoroughly. You know, typically like 9 or 12 questions. In the old days, pre-calc tests were like 30 questions. The questions were easier, but you have less questions, and you can afford to take your time to be really careful. All right. Now, what's the new stuff? Well, before we get to the new stuff, I want to take a moment to address one of the topics on the test that people struggled with the most, and it was actually pretty darn close to what we just did 5 seconds ago. Let's say I had that over this. And remember a second ago I had you do a domain that was just like this? Could you please find the domain for me? This isn't two separate functions, it's just one function. But you're going to say something about that and zero. You're going to say something about this and zero. You're going to put it all together on one number line and find the domain for me. I just want to make sure we've got this fixed. Because that one did not go so well for a lot of kids. Okay, first thing, x plus 8 greater than or equal to 0, x greater than or equal to negative 8. Raise your hand if you had that part right. Then you got to merge that with, if you can factor it, you should. Why is it smart? Because now I know 12 is the key and negative 12. Now remember, that's not what makes the function zero. That's what kills the function. It's a totally different thing. But that's what I care about on a domain, is I got to know what can I safely feed this function. I can't feed it 12s or negative 12s. I put empty spots right away, and I can never let it be that. Even if you were tempted to like say, oh, but I'm going to shade in something bigger than 12 or whatever, you can't ever let it be 12 or negative 12. All right, next I got to find something with the negative 8. That's in here somewhere, and that's an important spot. Now, how do you deal with shading in all the rest of it? Well, first of all, one of those three spots works. Like, it's okay to feed it one of those three numbers. Which one? Negative 8. If I give it a negative 8, it's kind of unusual because it makes it 0, but 0 is not crashing unless it's on the bottom. All right, now, if you had to, you could even test every region. Like, say, let me feed it a 13 and see if it works. And you'd find it doesn't crash. So, hey, it worked. But that's the slow way. The fast way is to just obey what you said. You said that x had to be bigger than negative 8. That's this way. Just be careful. That doesn't mean 12 all of a sudden works. Try it. Stick in a 12. It crashes. So 12 clearly still doesn't work. There is your answer in a number line form. Raise your hand if you had that one right. Okay, good. Now, what if it's a different question? What if all I wanted to know is what makes this function equal to 0? And what if I asked what makes this function, no, what is f of 0? Totally different thing. Find those two things. It's different than the domain. The domain is what is, can you safely feed it? I'm going to pause for a minute, see some people that are still puzzled. So let's see how you did. If I'm going to do this one first because it's so much easier. It's just telling me that x is 0. So I stick in 0. And that's 0 plus 8, which is 8, and that's square root of 8 over 0 minus 144 is negative 144. Now, technically, that's not reduced all the way. Did any of you go further and say it's root 4 and root 2, and therefore 2 root 2 over negative 144? Would you have to do that on the test? Well, you should reduce all the way. Am I saying I would never give credit for the root 8? It kind of depends on how hard the question was. Okay, but you should always reduce if you can. All right, that's the easy one. How about f of x equals 0? That's saying something different. That's not saying to stick in 0. That's saying f of x, the function, the whole function is 0. So this is 0. 0 is all that. Here's the common mistake. People think, so 12 makes it equal 0. No, 12 makes it crash. What makes it 0? Negative 8. Only one answer in this case. Are there ones that have multiple answers? Yeah, I think you had one that had three or four answers. There could be a ton of things that make it equal 0. All right. So, without further ado, I'm going to pause for a moment and do that little quiz in class here. In the new part of the lesson here, and if we take this, first of all, you have never seen this before, and I know that, but I'm going to interpret it for you. All right, underneath it, write this. G of f of 1. That little O there, you can think of it as an of. G of f of 1. Okay? Again, I kind of wish we just had one way to do the notation, but you will see this in different books in different ways, and therefore, on like the ACT test, this is fair game. Functions of functions is something that could be on the ACT, and this, they could write it this way. And it looks weird, but it means this. And this way it means is a lot easier for me, because then I just say always start on the inside, and then I just need to figure out f of 1. That's not hard. I'm just going to stick a 1 into the f function. So here's a 1 going in the f function, and that makes 1 minus 4 is negative 3. So I'm done with that now, and now the problem is different. It's g of, what did I come up with? Negative 3. It's just g of negative 3. Now you take the negative 3 and stick it in the other function. Okay, so this is f of g of x, except it's f of g of a number. And you start on the inside, and it's not that hard. So when I stick the negative 3 into the g function here, that is, and I stick negative 3 in here, and negative 3 plus 3 is 0, and is square root of 0 crash? No, square root of 0 is just 0. And then 2 minus 0 is just 2. So the answer for this one is 2. Not hard. Start on the inside. Would you please do number 2, just to make sure you really understand that. Do number 2 right now. First of all, interpret it as f of g of 1, and do it. The answer should come out to a number. I'll pause for a second while you get that figured out.